Welcome back, everyone. My name is Darmadi Komo. I'm a host for this session. With me, I have Luis Carlos from engineering team. Hey, Luis, why don't you tell us who you are and then what you're going to talk about today?
Sure, absolutely. Hi, everybody. My name is Luis Vargas. I'm a program manager on the SQL Server High Availability team. So today, we'll be talking about SQL Server High Availability and Disaster Recovery and Windows Azure Virtual Machines. So I'm really excited to talk about this. We have this new offering for running SQL Server in the cloud in Windows Azure. And we're going to be talking about how can you ensure high availability for your SQL Server running in a virtual machine in the cloud, as well as how can you achieve disaster recovery for your on-premise SQL Server databases using the cloud as well.
Okay, great. Why don't you show us what is Windows Azure VM?
Sure. So let's start with an overview first of what Windows Azure VMs are, and then we'll go into SQL Server running on Windows Azure.
Okay.
So first, Windows Azure VMs, basically what this means is you can have virtual machines hosted in Windows Azure, what we call infrastructure as a service. And this basically means that there is a host machine that is hosting virtual machines for you. You can have these virtual machines, you can create, you bring your own images. So you can prepare, for example, BHDs on-premise and then upload them to the cloud. And provision virtual machines out of those images, or you can create virtual machines from the images that Microsoft provides. And we have many images for the different products that we have in Microsoft. One of those products is SQL Server. Provisioning a virtual machine is really fast. So in less than 10 minutes, you can have a virtual machine running SQL Server in the cloud. You only pay for what you use, so this is a fantastic offering. So you only pay for every minute that you use that virtual machine. You don't pay for more than that. How much you pay will depend on the size of the virtual machine. We have many different sizes with different numbers of cores, different amounts of memory. And based on that is how the price is determined. And also there is some cost associated with the licensing. So if you're running SQL Server, for example, there is some licensing cost associated with that.
But I save money on my hardware. I don't need to worry about hardware upgrade and maintaining the hardware and all that.
Absolutely, yes. So you don't have to think about buying all that expensive hardware. The moment that you need it, you just provision a virtual machine, and then you have SQL Server running there.
Okay, awesome.
In terms of the network, you only pay for outgoing traffic, not incoming. So actually, it seems there is a hint there in the deck. You only pay for the storage that you use. So even if you allocate multiple terabytes of space, for example, for your virtual machine, you only pay for the space that you actually use in those machines. It's an elastic offering. What this means is that at some point you may start, for example, with a small virtual machine, and you may have only one core, for example, and 2 gigabytes of RAM. But you can go and increase this into 8 cores, for example, and 56 gigabytes of RAM. Same thing on the storage. You can start, for example, with less than 1 terabyte, and you can go all the way to 16 terabytes of data.
Wow.
So it's a really elastic offering, and you can just do this by changing a couple of properties in the Windows Azure portal. And we will actually show some of that in the demo.
Okay, great.
Finally, this is still an infrastructure as a service offering. And what this means is you are in charge of the virtual machine itself. So if you need to do patching, for example, of that virtual machine or SQL Server inside of that virtual machine, that's something that you still need to manage.
So I still have full control of the
You have full control of the virtual machine,
right?
Okay. It's just another machine, but it's running in the cloud.
Okay.
In terms of storage, every disk that you attach to that virtual machine where you can store your data, it's storing what we call Azure Storage, which is basically a centralized system, which is highly available, highly secure. And the way this works is for every disk that you have, we have 3 copies running in Windows Azure Storage so that we can ensure that you never lose your data. So even if one of the copies goes down or 2 of the copies goes down, you still have an additional copy. It's highly transparent. So let's say that one of the disks goes down for some reason, we'll automatically switch to another disk under the covers, and this will be transparent to the virtual machine. And this is what this is illustrated in the picture that we're seeing here. So you have 3 copies of your disk running in Windows Azure Storage. In addition, we have 3 more asynchronous copies in a different data center. And this is so that in case that one of the data centers goes down, for example, you have a different copy in a different data center where you can continue running as well.
Okay.
So highly available and support disaster recovery as well. In terms of high availability, I want to introduce first what the platform offers in terms of high availability for your virtual machines, okay. And then we can drill down into SQL Server high availability. So just from the platform perspective, the way it works is you have different racks, right? And each of these racks has multiple physical hosts, and then these hosts have virtual machines. And then the way it works is you can put your virtual machines in what is called an availability set. An availability set is a concept from Windows Azure, and what that ensures is that all the virtual machines that you put there end up in different racks.
Okay.
Right. So that in case that one rack becomes unavailable for some reason, because there is a cable, for example, that fails, you still have a different virtual machine in a different rack that you can access. Right.
So it's no single point of failure.
There is no single point of failure, exactly. Yeah. And then traditionally, what applications do is they have some load balancer, right, between the application and the virtual machines, so that load balancer is routing those requests to both virtual machines. In case that one of the virtual machines goes down for some reason, you still have another virtual machine where you can route all the requests.
Right.
So that's just a general context of how applications in general handle high availability, and it's going to be useful when we talk about SQL Server high availability.
Okay.
So let's start talking about SQL Server on Windows Azure VMs. And let's talk about first about high availability and disaster recovery, because that's what we're going to focus most of the discussion today. So in terms of high availability, the first SLA that we have is you will never lose any data. So we guarantee you that through the three copies of data that you'll always have your data available. If a virtual machine becomes unavailable for some reason, right, and this reason could be, for example, let's say that there is an upgrade that is happening on the host machine, right? At that point, the virtual machine will automatically restart in a different host, right? So there is an SLA from Windows Azure. The SLA is for when you add one or more virtual machines in an availability set.
Right.
And the SLA is 99.95 minutes, which means that less than 22 minutes of downtime per month, right? So this means that over 1 month, at most, 22 minutes, you won't have any of the VMs accessible. Right.
Okay.
And this SLA includes planned downtime due to monthly patching of the host machine. Right. So every month we do patching of those host machines. And also includes unplanned downtime due to physical failures. So if for some reason the physical host fails, that is included as part of the SLA. So you don't have to worry about that. Mm. This still doesn't include anything that you do inside of the virtual machine. So if you, for example, go and patch the operating system, that won't be included as part of this SLA, and that's something that you need to handle, and we'll talk about how you can do that. In terms of disaster recovery, currently we don't have an SLA, but based on empirical tests that we have run, it's less than 30 minutes of potential data loss between data centers. So let's say that one data center goes down, which so far hasn't happened, and in the worst case scenario, you will have less than 30 minutes of data loss. And the reason is that you have an asynchronous process that is replicating the data between data centers, and we don't do it synchronously because we don't want to impact the performance on the primary data center.
Okay, got it. But it is a full version of SQL Server, meaning that all the features are supported. I can run SQL Server application there as if I run it on-prem.
Exactly, and we have one slide, I think the next slide that we'll talk about that. Something else that I wanted to describe is we have external connectivity to these Windows Azure VMs. So you can connect to these VMs over the internet, right? Just you can create what is called public endpoint, and you can just connect to them over that endpoint. Or you can have a site-to-site tunnel for secure connectivity between your on-premise environment and Windows Azure. So you can create what is called the site-to-site tunnel, and this will basically allow you to extend your on-premise domain into Windows Azure. So by doing this, for example, you have access to all the domain credentials that you have in your premise environment, and you can use those to authenticate into virtual machines in the cloud. Mm. Right? So very powerful mechanism. For example, if you want to be able to apply all those policies that you have today on-premise, policies, for example, regarding firewalls and things like that, you can just extend your domain into some of those virtual machines in Azure, and those policies will apply there. In addition, you can use your Windows domain credentials, for example, to authenticate to those virtual machines. So people who are using Windows authentication today, for example, for SQL Server, could continue using that into those virtual machines in the cloud without having to change the security settings.
Okay.
This is what we're showing here, so you can have your on-premise environment, right? The way this works is you either configure a VPN device, like your Cisco router, et cetera, or you can configure Windows Remote Access Services in Windows Server, and you can have a software-based side-to-side tunnel between your on-premise environment and Windows Azure. And on the Windows Azure side, we have a gateway that basically establishes the secure connection.
Right.
So we're talking about SQL Server in Windows Azure VMs. We have many versions of SQL Server supported. So we support since SQL Server 2008 or 2, SQL 2012, and now we even have SQL Server 2014, CTP1, and recently we released CTP2 as well. So you can go and play with that. We have, we're saying, almost 100% compatibility. The only thing that we are currently working on is supporting SQL Server failover clusters, right? Besides that, everything else in the programmability surface is supported.
Okay, like integration services is
integration
there.
Integration
services is reporting there. Services is
reporting
there.
Reporting services, yes.
Okay.
Analysis services, spatial data, yeah. Whatever you can think of is there.
Okay, awesome.
Right, and as we described before, because you own the virtual machine, you still own SQL Server, right? So you can manage your security, you can manage your backups, and you can even go and manage high availability and disaster recovery. And we'll talk about why would you want to do that.
Now I'm so eager to see what it looks like. Can you show us in the portal?
Yeah, absolutely. So let me show you quickly how this works. So let me show here. All right, so what we have here is the Windows Azure portal, mm-hmm. right? So you can see here we have all the different services that we offer in the cloud. All right, so let's see, you can see it here, okay? So we have all the services here that you can offer in the cloud. The first one that we're going to talk about is virtual machines. So if you want to go and provision a new virtual machine, all you have to do is click on New, right? And then you can select virtual machine here. And you can specify if you want a quick create from gallery. I'm just going to do it from gallery to show some of the options that we have in the gallery. So here you can see all the different types of images that we support. Right? So you can see, for example, that for SQL Server, we have SQL Server 2014, CTP2. We have 2012, SP1 Enterprise. We have images for data warehousing. We have standard edition. We have web edition. All the way back to 2008 or 2.
Okay.
So you can select one of these. So for now, I'm going to select 2014 CTP2, the latest image that we released a couple of months ago. It gives you some information about SQL Server here. I can give a name to my virtual machine, so I can say my VM, give it some unique number there. I can select the size of the virtual machine, so this can go from extra small, you know, just one core and 768 megabytes of memory, all the way to A7, which is the largest VM that we have today with 8 cores and 56. So for now, I'm going to select a large one. I can give a name to my administrator. So I'm going to say Bill Vargas. And I can give it a password. And this is the password that I'll use to manage the virtual machine. Matching that one. Okay, let me make sure I have it here. Okay, so after that, I can specify where do I want to create it. So the cloud service is basically a container. So if I have multiple SQL servers, for example, and maybe the mid-tier and some web servers, I can put it in the same cloud service. And it's just a container for my application.
Okay.
I'm going to tell it to create a new cloud service. I can give it a DNS name. And this is a name that I can use to connect over the internet to that virtual machine if I want to.
Okay.
Here I can select where do I want to locate this. So I can either say I want it in a specific region. Right? I can put it in North Europe, West US, Central US, all the different data centers that we have around the world. Or I can put it in what is called a virtual network. And this virtual network is basically the side-to-side tunnel that I talked about before. So I have created, for example, two virtual networks here. And mm-hmm. we'll look at this later in the demo.
Okay.
But basically, these virtual networks establish connectivity between my on-premise environment and some region in Windows Azure.
Okay.
So by putting it in one of these, it will go. It will be accessible to my on-premise domain with all my security credentials there. So let me select this one, for example. Some information about subnets, so people who have different subnets can use that. And also the storage account. So I can have different accounts that I can associate with different storage spaces. And what this means is I can manage my storage, right, to different accounts. So some people, for example, may require a lot of storage. I create one storage account and I assign it to them.
Okay.
Right, so in this case, I can say automatically generate one. We talk about the concept of availability set. So if I want to make sure that these VMs are in different racks, I will put them in the same availability set. In this case, this is only one, so I won't do that. Finally, I can select how do I want to be able to connect to this virtual machine. So I can, for example, enable the remote desktop endpoint. Right? If I want to go and connect to remote desktop, I can enable remote PowerShell if I want to run remote PowerShell commandlets, etc. And then after that, I can go and execute this, and 10 minutes later, I'll have a virtual machine running with SQL Server. So hopefully that gives an idea of, you know, the, how the provisioning process works. Mm-hmm. So let's go back to the presentation.
Yeah, you alluded earlier about having SLA, right, 99 point,
yeah,
something, right, in Azure by, yeah, itself, has three copies and everything.
Yeah.
But for a lot of our customers, they want actually higher SLA, meaning that they want more high availability.
Right.
Yeah, so
right.
I want, if you can describe, how do we do HA and DR within Azure VM?
Sure, absolutely. Absolutely. So let's talk about the SQL Server HA and DR scenarios in Windows Azure VMs. Mm-hmm. As you mentioned, well, the platform already provides some high availability and disaster recovery, mm-hmm, but on top of that, you can even achieve higher levels, mm-hmm, if you want to, through SQL Server.
Right.
So let's discuss this. So we have two scenarios. The first one is you have your SQL Server running in a Windows Azure VM, and you want to make sure that you have high availability for SQL Server, right? The way this works is exactly the same way it works on-premise, where you can have replicas, mm-hmm, right? And those replicas are available for automatic failover, so that if the primary replica goes down, you have another replica that can take over very quickly. Mm-hmm. So we'll talk about that, and we'll give more details. The second scenario is achieving disaster recovery for your on-premise SQL Server. So that SQL Server that you're running today, mm-hmm, in your company, you may want to protect it in case that your full data center, for example, becomes unavailable.
Right.
So you can have a different copy, one or more copies now running in Windows Azure that are available to you, so that in case that your on-premise environment is unavailable, you can fail over to that copy in the cloud and continue running your applications there.
Okay. Got it.
So let's talk about the first scenario, mm-hmm, high availability for SQL Server in Windows Azure. So why would you need to do this? Well, the first reason is that the failure detection that Windows Azure does is at the virtual machine level. So there is a heartbeat mechanism going on between the host machine and the virtual machines that it hosts, and it will detect failures in the virtual machine. However, it will not detect failures inside of the virtual machine because for privacy reasons, that's your virtual machine and we don't see inside of it.
Okay.
Right? So you may want to be able to detect failures in SQL Server, for example. You may also be able to quickly have another SQL Server running in case that you want to patch your SQL Server, right? So you have some PCUs and CUs, and if you want to patch SQL Server, that requires some downtime, right? And to avoid that, you may want to continue running in a different SQL Server. And finally, you may want to patch the operating system itself in that virtual machine. Right? Mm-hmm. So you may want to patch Windows, and as part of that, you may want to, again, fail over to a different SQL Server. The other reason is the process of service healing. Service healing is when Windows Azure detects that for some reason the host machine hosting the virtual machine is unavailable. In that case, Windows Azure will restart that virtual machine in a different host. That process today takes around 12 minutes, right? So for applications that cannot support 12 minutes of downtime, they will need to configure a high availability solution for SQL.
Okay.
Right? And the final thing is every month there is an upgrade process that happens one day, right? Couple of hours, where Windows Azure goes and upgrade all the operating systems for all the host machines, right, in the data center. Now, that means that during some time, that virtual machine is going to be impacted, right? And that's around 15 minutes today. So while the upgrade happens, your virtual machine may be down for 15 minutes. So again, if you don't want to, or your application cannot support that downtime, then you can configure a high availability solution for SQL.
Okay.
So what do you do? Well, what you do is the same way that you do today on-premise. You can configure a high availability technology for SQL Server, where in this case, we have this in Windows Azure, and you can have three virtual machines. You can have your primary,
yep,
your secondary, and what is called the witness, right? And the witness is basically the additional entity that orchestrates automatic failover, right?
Right.
So in this case, if, for example, the primary goes down, The secondary will automatically become the new primary, right? Your applications can continue running there. At some point in time, the previous primary will come online.
Right.
Right? Now it will come back as a secondary, and it will start resynchronizing transactions again from the primary. Right? And that's how you can achieve high availability continuously in Windows Azure. Now, what this provides is failure detection for SQL Server. So if there is anything impacting SQL Server, for example, a continuous out of memory situation, that will be detected by the SQL Server HA technology, and then the failover will take very little time. It's around 15 seconds.
Okay.
And 15 seconds is a lot better than 15 minutes, for example. So if you want to have that very high level of high availability, you can do this.
Okay.
In terms of technologies, the technologies that we support to do this are the same technologies that people are familiar on-premise today. So you probably have used already availability groups that we released in SQL Server 2012.
Yeah, you
can achieve, obviously, zero data loss. Right? We ensure that if there is an automatic failover, the new primary contains all the data that we have before in the secondary. You can have many databases in the scope of an availability group. So if you have an application that takes a dependency, for example, in three databases, you can put those three databases in the same availability group, and the availability group will fail over all of those databases together.
Okay.
You can have many replicas. So in SQL Server 2012, we supported four secondaries. In SQL Server 2014, we support eight secondaries, nine replicas in total. Mm-hmm. So you can have all those levels of protection if you want to.
Okay.
Obviously, we support automatic failover, and your secondaries can be readable. And what this means is you can use these secondaries, for example, to offload some of the reporting workloads out of the primary and run them there. Yeah. Right? We also support database mirroring, right? A solution that we have supported in the past, still supported. The scope is a single database, so if you want to configure high availability for multiple databases, then you configure database mirroring for each of those.
Right.
I wanted to mention availability groups have many advantages. So besides all the capabilities that we described before, like readable secondaries, you can have flexible failover policies, where you can specify different conditions that will cause SQL Server to fail over. You have automatic page repair, where we detect that a page is unhealthy, is corrupted, then automatically we request that page from other secondaries, and then we'll replace that page. We support backup on secondaries. So you want to move some of your backups to the secondaries to save IO resources, for example, you can do that. And support for other features like file stream and full file table, etc. Something that is important to remember is with availability groups, you need to install a Windows cluster.
Okay.
Right? You don't need shared storage. Some people sometimes believe that they need, you don't need it. All you need to have is install Windows cluster between the machines.
Right.
Right? And these machines need to be part of the same Windows domain. Right? So you need to make sure that if you configure this in the cloud, that you configure an Active Directory domain controller. And we have all the instructions of how to do this.
Okay.
something that is important for people who go and configure high availability in Windows Azure is you need to make sure that you tell Windows Azure that where to allocate these virtual machines, right? It's important because in this case, the environment is a cloud environment, right? And you want to make sure that your virtual machines end in the best possible way, in the best possible place, sorry. So there are three things that you need to think of. One is make sure that these virtual machines are part of the same affinity group. This is a concept from Windows Azure. And basically, this means are part of the same Azure cluster. And a cluster is a set of racks that are close together.
Okay.
And the reason why you want to do this is because you want your primary and your secondary to be close, because you want to reduce latency between them.
I see.
Right? You want to make sure that your secondary is continuously synchronizing as fast as possible. You want to make sure that they are part of the same availability set, as we described before. Mm-hmm. This basically means they're different racks, right? this also ensures that they are in different upgrade domains. And what this means is that every month, that day when Windows Azure does an upgrade, it will only upgrade one of those virtual machines at a time, right? So you can ensure that at least you have the rest of the other virtual machines running, right? Mm-hmm. And that's how you can ensure that there is a failover and you can continue running on another virtual machine. And finally, make sure that your virtual machines are part of the same virtual network, right? The virtual network will ensure that the IPs of those virtual machines never change.
I see.
Right? And this is important because in the case that that virtual machine moves to a different host machine, you want it to maintain the same IP, because if not, changing the IP in the DNS may take some time, and that's time that you may not be able to connect to your virtual machine using the name, only the IP. Right? So if, to avoid that, just use a virtual network, and then your IPs always remain the same. And you can always connect to the name with, without any delay. This is an example of the type of configurations that you can achieve in Windows Azure. So in the same availability group, you can have multiple replicas. So in this case, for example, we have one primary and one secondary, right? And then you have your OLTP application that is running transactions into a SQL Server. And it is connecting to the primary through something called the listener. And the listener is a DNS name that your application can use to find the primary. Yeah. Right? So even if there is a failover here to replica S1, your application will be able to connect transparently to that one. And then you can have, you're probably wondering what these readable secondaries are. So yeah. You can have multiple readable secondaries, mm-hmm. right? And if you have, for example, one or more reporting applications that need to use your data, right? You can move those reporting applications into your readable secondaries, right? And you can do things like configuring and load balancer in Windows Azure, and then you can load balance all those requests for the reporting applications across all the readable secondaries. So very powerful way of how to scale out your application, for example, in the cloud.
This is all great. We can do all this in the cloud.
Yeah.
I'm sure that some of my customers, they're thinking like, I'm not that ready yet to move my primary machine to the cloud yet.
Yeah.
I want to make sure that all my mission critical databases are stay on-prem.
Exactly.
And I want to use Azure just for my disaster recovery scenario.
Exactly.
Is that possible?
Absolutely, absolutely. Yeah. So actually, let's go and show the portal again. I wanted to show how can you go and configure this tunnel that I mentioned before on-premise on the cloud so that you can have this secure connectivity between the two. So let's talk about how can you achieve disaster recovery for your on-premise SQL Server in Windows Azure. Okay, let me talk a little bit about the why, and then we'll look at the tunnel. So why would you want to do this? So the main reason is there are events that you don't foresee, and these events may cause your SQL Server to become unavailable. Some of these may be temporary, and they may be just there may be a gateway failure, for example, that is causing connectivity to fail to that SQL Server, but they may be permanent as well. There may be flooding scenarios, for example. So we saw cases, for example, in New York with Sandy, with Hurricane Sandy, that some of the data centers actually became impacted because of that. And in those cases, people who have disaster recovery sites were able to continue running by doing a failover to, right. to a different data center. Mm-hmm. Right? So the problem is a disaster recovery site is expensive. Right? You need to pay for rent for the site. You need to pay for maintenance. You need to buy the hardware. You need to maintain the hardware. You need to pay someone to be able to take care of the site, right? Some operations people. So because of that, we believe there is substantial value in having a solution that is cost effective for you. And what we are doing now is since seven months ago, we started supporting disaster recovery replicas in Windows Azure. Okay. And this is what is shown in this picture. So in your on-premise environment, you will have your primary, you will have your secondary for automatic failover. So you still have your high availability managed locally, right? But if you want to have an additional copy, one or more copies outside of your data center, you can go and add these replicas in Windows Azure Virtual Machines. And now these are SQL Server copies that will be continuously synchronizing all your transactions from on-premise, right? So that at any point you can fail over to those replicas and continue running. So what you can do is you can deploy, as I mentioned, one or more secondary replicas for your on-premise SQL Server. These replicas continually synchronize. So the way this works is every transaction that you execute in SQL Server will create a log record, right? And we automatically send those log records into the secondary in the cloud, right? And that replica in the cloud will have a copy that is up to date with the primary. As I mentioned before, that replica in the cloud is using Windows Azure Storage to store all the data. And as we described, Windows Azure Storage is highly available, has three copies, and also has its own disaster recovery solution. So you can guarantee that never you will lose any data that you send into that replica in the cloud.
Okay.
So very powerful mechanism. You can put these replicas in the best region for you, So we have many regions today. We have more coming. So we have West US, for example, East US. We have regions in Asia. We have regions in North Europe and West Europe, et cetera. Right? As I mentioned, there are new regions coming as we talk. How do you decide where to put it? This will depend on a couple of things. One is latency. Mm-hmm. So you want to make sure that you keep latency relatively small. Relatively small, you know, within 60, 70 millisecond round trip between your primary data center and the cloud. And also, I know that there are some countries that have some political considerations on where or where they cannot keep the data, right? Some of those countries can look into some of the regions that we have and decide based on that. Mm-hmm. Very important, very low TCO, total cost of ownership. The only thing that you pay for is the virtual machine and the storage, right? As we described before, all the traffic that you send into the virtual machine is free. Okay. Right? So if you're synchronizing transactions from on-premise to the cloud, this is very important because you don't have to pay for that traffic. Right? Something to mention at this point is I actually have seen some customers where they invert the deployments. So they actually run the primary and the secondary in the cloud. Right? So the application is running in the cloud, but they want to keep a local copy on-premise. Some people like to maintain that copy, for example, for local reporting reasons, or some have actually compliance and policy reasons where they need to maintain a local copy. Like there are some hospitals, for example, that need to have some local copy of the data. So even if they're running some applications in the cloud, they need to maintain that. So that's totally possible, and you can do that as well.
In this scenario, does the traffic that comes from the cloud to on-prem, do we have to pay for that traffic?
From the cloud to on-prem? Mm-hmm. In this case, yes. So the outgoing traffic that goes from the Azure data center into on-premise, yeah, you have to pay for that.
Okay.
And if there are questions about how much, there is in the portal information mm-hmm. about the different limits and how much you have to pay for those.
Okay.
All right. In terms of how do you go and configure this? So we have many technologies today already on-premise that people have been using to enable disaster recovery. And they can continue using this for these, we call it hybrid scenarios, where your replicas are in Windows Azure. So you can do this, for example, through availability groups, again, right? You can do it through database mirroring, or you can do it through log chipping. So people who have been using log chipping, they can use that as well. Here, in terms of zero data loss, you could, in theory, achieve zero data loss if you want to. The reason why we mark it as no here is because in general, when people configure disaster recovery solutions between data centers, they configure these replicas as asynchronous.
Okay.
And the reason why they did do that is because they don't want to block transactions on the primary, waiting for acknowledgments back from the secondary saying that the transaction is stored safely there. Mm-hmm. In some cases, it may be possible. For example, if you're very close between the data centers, you know, if you have less than 20 millisecond latency, for example, you may be able to configure that. But in large majority of cases, you don't want to have any impact on your performance on the primary, so you configure this as asynchronous. And what this means is we don't block transactions on the primary. We send them continuously to the secondary. But it may be possible that the secondary may fall behind
right.
for some reason. Mm-hmm. For example, there may be a network glitch. What that means is that if at that point in time you try to do a failover, it's possible that there may be some data loss, right? And obviously you have all the information in SQL Server about what was the last transaction time, what was the last transaction, even the last transaction sequence number that was committed in that secondary. And that's how you can compare that and take a decision if you want to failover or not. So we talk about database mirroring, we talk about log chipping. There are different advantages for availability groups. Mm-hmm. First one is you have an integrated solution for high availability and disaster recovery. So you can have, for example, one replica for high availability in local data center, and then you can have one or more replicas in Windows Azure, and you have a single solution to configure and manage and monitor. So that's a very powerful statement there. You're able to offload read workloads to Azure. Mm-hmm. This is very important, for example, for people who have reporting applications that want to move those out of the primary. If you put your secondary in the cloud, you can start changing your connection strings and pushing those reporting workloads there. Mm. Right? Many people I have seen they actually migrate some of these applications into the cloud and then just run them against the local secondaries in the cloud just to reduce even more the latency, right? Okay. So that's something else that you can start looking into how you architect these new hybrid applications. You can offload backups to Azure. Again, this is a very powerful capability. Many customers would like to have backups outside of the data center so that they're always available in case that the data center becomes unavailable and they can go back in time, for example, to a restore. Mm. They can do this by taking some of these backups on the secondary replicas of an availability group.
Okay. So
powerful capability. Again, in the case of availability groups, we have the requirement of Windows cluster, right? And this means that that secondary in the cloud and your on-premise SQL Server need to be running in the same Windows cluster. And because of that, they need to be running in the same Windows domain.
Okay.
Right? Now, to achieve this, if you want to make sure that those secondaries can be part of the same Windows domain as on-premise, you need to configure what we talk about. This is the side-to-side tunnel. And you can do this using a VPN device or Windows Server Remote Access Services. So actually, I think it's a good point now to go and show some of the tunnels and see how they look from the portal. So let me close this. So in the portal, if you go to networks, right, we'll see that we have some tunnels here. So let me show you an example of this. So we can go here into the dashboard here for the tunnel. And it'll give us some information about the tunnel itself. The way you configure this tunnel is you go into Windows Azure, and you specify you define basically a virtual network where you specify an IP address range, right? So you say, I want to define a virtual network. This is the lower bound of the IP address. This is the higher bound. And then you can generate a public key, right? That public key is a public key that you can go and use on-premise to configure your side-to-side tunnel. And you can configure that, again, using VPN physical device, or you can just configure this in Windows Server Remote Access Services. Mm-hmm. Once you do that, you have what we see here in the screen. So this will show you, for example, that on-premise, I have connectivity here. If for some reason connectivity goes down, this is shown as a red line. But in this case, basically green means that connectivity is successful right now. And then we have the virtual network that we described before in the cloud. You have information about all the data that has gone into the cloud. All the data has gone out of the cloud. There is an IP address for the gateway where mm-hmm. you connect to, right? And you can connect to that IP address. We have some information about all the virtual machines that are part of that virtual network. And what this means is you can access all of these virtual machines as if they were part of your on-premise domain.
I see.
Right? You can even authenticate to those virtual machines using your domain credentials. Mm-hmm. So very powerful capability. They have an IP address in the context of the virtual network as well. And then let's see if there is anything else interesting here that we want to show. I think for now is good enough. So let's go back to the presentation. Okay, let's see what else we have here. So this is how a sample deployment looks like. So on the on-premise environment, for example, I can have my SQL servers running. So I have here, for example, my primary, right? I have my secondary. They're part of the same availability group, and that's how I achieve high availability, right? And then on-premise, I have my Active Directory domain controller. There is a VPN device, yeah. right? And that VPN device establishes the tunnel to the Windows Azure gateway. In the cloud, now I can have one or more secondary replicas, right? And these secondary replicas become part of the same availability group and become part of the same Windows cluster. Right? Something that you'll notice is the DNS suffix of machines in the cloud actually have a different suffix than the one that I have on-premise, right? And that's how you can distinguish this, for example. So in on-premise, I'll have my redmond.core Microsoft domain, whereas in the cloud, I'll have something like US West or the different regions where I put it, and then cloudapp.net, et cetera.
Right. So this is all good. And some of the customers that I have here, they're not familiar that much with Windows Azure
right.
As much, but they're familiar with SQL Server and always-on technology and all that stuff.
Right.
When we come up with this solution that allows you to have DR in the cloud, anything you can, we can do to help them to get to the Azure faster without having to learn all about Azure and all that.
Absolutely. So before running into the demo, something that I wanted to show is, let me go here. So SQL Server, high availability, in Windows Azure VM. So here we'll find all the documentation associated with all the scenarios that we have been talking about. Mm-hmm. So you just search and you go into this site, you'll find information about all the different scenarios. So for example, we'll talk about high availability, right? And you can look at how to do this through availability groups, right? How can you ensure high availability, right? And then how can you do it through database mirroring, right? Then we'll talk about disaster recovery solutions, right? So again, we talk about how can you do this through database mirroring, how can you do this through backup and restore, for example, Windows Azure storage. Then for disaster recovery solutions in hybrid scenarios, where you want to have these replicas in the cloud for your on-premise environments, we show you how to do this again with availability groups, right? So you have tutorials and information for this, and also for database mirroring, as well as for log shipping, and even with backup and restore to Windows Azure Storage. So we have all this information in place. I think this is a great way to go and start familiarizing yourself with all of this. We have all the tutorials on the left side. We have tutorials using graphical in screenshots, for example, so you can look into how to do this, you know, all these steps using you know, these tutorials. And it talks about how to configure a domain controller, for example, how to create the virtual machines. What else do we have here? How to create a Windows cluster in the cloud, right? How to go and configure the availability group, right? So we have all the information here, very detailed tutorial with all the screenshots. For people who are more familiar with PowerShell, we have the tutorials with PowerShell as well. So you can go here and they can use some of these tutorials. We even have a script, a PowerShell script that configures high availability end to end. So people who want to do it in the simplest way, they can just go and run the PowerShell script, and it will do it for them.
Okay, awesome. Right? Very comprehensive.
Yes. So I think at this point, let's go back to the presentation. There's a couple of cool things that I want to show. So let me move forward. And I'll show some of the things that we have in SQL Server 2014, CTP2. So many people may be wondering, so how do I go and add this replica in the cloud? I show you the tutorials. You can go and do that. You can go and do it manually. In SQL Server 2014, we're going one step further, and we're really, really simplifying how you can go and do this. So let me talk about, I think we talked about this one already. Why you want to go and add replicas in the cloud. We talk about this. What I wanted to show is this demo. So in SQL Server 2014, we're simplifying how to add this replica in the cloud through SQL Server itself. So let me go and show you this. All right, so what you have here in the screen, right, is an availability group. We have you have many availability groups, but I have one here in particular that I'll be using, AG. The availability group has a couple of replicas already, right? Primary and secondary for high availability, and it's protecting one database, right? DB5. Now, you can see in the dashboard that these replicas are configured for automatic failover, right? That they are synchronized, right? At this point in time, I could go and add another replica. Let's say that I want to add a replica in Windows Azure. So what can I do? So I can click, right-click on Availability Replicas, and then I have Add Replica. Add Replica will bring the traditional wizard that we have since SQL Server 2012 for adding a replica to your availability group. It's the same wizard as before, but now we have added a new button. A new button is called Add Azure Replica. If I click on this button will bring this screen, which is very similar to the screen that we have in the Windows Azure portal. And this screen will allow me to connect to Windows Azure, specifying my credentials, and after that, specify, for example, the size of the virtual machine that I want to provision in Windows Azure. So the first thing that I have to do is connect to Windows Azure. So if I have connected in the past, it will remember my credentials, and I don't have to do it again.
Right.
But if I have never connected, I can go and sign into it. So I can specify my Live ID credential, for example. Right. And then once I specify that, the wizard will automatically download a management certificate that I can use to authenticate all the operations that I do to Windows Azure. And it also downloads a list of subscriptions. So with my Live ID account, I may have multiple subscriptions that I want to manage. So I can select which of these subscriptions I want to use. After that, I click Connect. And it'll take a little bit of time for the wizard to connect to Windows Azure. Once it connects, it downloads the list. It automatically populates some of these fields with information from my subscription. So for example, it will download the set of images that I have available in the system. Mm-hmm. It will, by default, select the best image. So it will detect what operating system I'm running, what SQL Server version I'm running, and it will select that one by default.
Okay.
I can select different sizes of virtual machines. So again, I can go from a small one to the very large one with 8 cores and 56 gigabytes of RAM. I can give a name, for example, to my virtual machine. I can specify, again, my username. The same things that we did before in the portal, now I can do it through SQL Server itself. Right? So this shows the integration between both the SQL Server product and the Windows Azure cloud provider. And then I can select in which region I want to create my replica. Right? So I can put it, for example, in Central US, West Europe, et cetera. If I want to, I can put it in a specific subnet. After that, I need to give it a credential for my domain mm-hmm. that has permissions to add a machine to my on-premise domain, right? Because I need to be able to add that virtual machine into my on-premise domain so that it can become part of the domain and part of the same Windows cluster.
Right.
So I give it a domain credential here for my Redmond domain. Right? I give it my password. After that, this secondary is added to the list of secondaries that are in the system. I can configure it as readable if I want to, and just by configuring it as readable, my applications can connect and read from that secondary.
Okay.
The next thing that I do is I specify how do I want to move my data, my copy of the data from on-premise into Windows Azure. I have different options by default. We select full, mm-hmm. and full basically means I'll take a full backup from my database, and then I share that in a network share, and then I restore that from the share into that virtual machine in the cloud, mm-hmm. right? How long this will take, it'll depend on the size of the virtual machine. Mm-hmm. Sorry, not on the size of the virtual machine, in the size of the database on-premise.
Yeah.
After I do that, the wizard will go and do many validations for me, right? As you can see, it's a complex setup, it's a complex environment, right? And the wizard wants to ensure that I have success at the end of it. So it'll go and validate things, for example, like ensuring that the image of the virtual machine that I select is appropriate to support all availability groups, for example. It will verify that I have enough space in my storage account in the cloud, that we talk about the cloud service and how it's a container for my SQL Server, that cloud service is healthy, right, that is running. It will check, for example, that the VM size supports the number of disks that I require. So again, different VM sizes support different numbers of disks. So it will look into my on-premise configuration. It will look at how many disks I have, and based on that, it will make sure that that size that I select in Azure can host all of those disks, right? And it will check the compatibility level between the primary and the secondary and all that.
Right.
And after that, it'll show me all the choices that I did in the wizard, right? So it will show me, for example, the backup location, the name of the virtual machine that I'll provision, the location, like Central US in this case, the size of the virtual machine, et cetera. It'll show me information about the disks that will be allocated for that virtual machine, et cetera. And at the end of this, basically, the wizard will run. Again, how long it takes, it depends on the size of the database. Provisioning the virtual machine takes around 8 minutes right now.
Okay.
There's always work trying to reduce that time. And after that, the main thing is restoring the backup from on-premise to the cloud. Once you finish that, basically you have a replica in the cloud that is synchronizing from on-premise. So very powerful mechanism of how you can go in a simple way, go on and add this replica in the cloud.
Okay. So it takes away all the complexity of, you can do it manually.
Absolutely.
You have a tutorial, you can do it manually.
Absolutely.
But this one will help you a lot.
Yeah, so people, for example, that are running still on SQL 2008 or 2, for example, you can even go today and configure a database mirroring session, right? And you can add your replica in the cloud. People who are using availability groups in SQL 2012, they can go and do it manually, right? People who are in SQL Server 2014 can now leverage the wizard to do this in an automated way.
Right. Okay, great.
So let's go back to... let's go back to this one. All right. So at this point, I just wanted to, again, let people have some time to look at the resources, some of the things that can help them go and start becoming familiar with these scenarios that we have discussed. The first place to go is the place that I showed you, the SQL Server HADR on Windows Azure. We have all the tutorials there, all the scripts that you you can use. If you want to become familiar with some of the other aspects, for example, how to create the virtual tunnel, there is also a site that you can go to. Finally, if you want to learn, for example, how to set up an Active Directory domain controller in the cloud, there is also a tutorial for that. So if any of these scenarios are you want to go and play with, then go into each of these sites.
Yep. Well, they have a chance to download the PowerPoint so they can look at the links and all that.
Okay, good.
Well, thank you so much, Luis.
Thank you
for today's session. Hopefully everyone will learn a lot about this session. And we'll take a 15-minute break right now, and we'll be back with another super exciting session on SQL Server 2014. Thank you, guys.
Thank you.